3, 2, 1, 0. We have commitment. We have liftoff at 2:13.
All right, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the U.S. Space and Rocket Center. Welcome to another event of our celebration of the 50th anniversary of Apollo 11. Our theme this year, as many of you know, is to celebrate the past and inspire the future. And these panels have not disappointed. We have had tremendous panels, both celebrating and then taking a look at where we are and looking forward. We spent considerable time, and our subject matter experts are part of our DNA at the Rocket Center, so we thank you so much for your participation. If you have folks come in, we're getting close to tight on seats, so if you need to move in a little, that would be great as well. We are continuing our Pass the Torch series with participants from industry, academia, government, community. And we're so grateful that that they can share their insights. We are capturing these oral histories to celebrate Apollo. Our Pass the Torch series features many aspects, and today it was that age-old question of how do you have mobility when you get where you're going to explore. So this should be a really great panel today. We want to say thank you to our Pass the Torch supporters and sponsors. These series have been open to the public both here and at the Huntsville Public Library, and we thank everybody, a host of volunteers and professionals who have helped to put all this together. If we might also recognize Intuitive Research as our Apollo 50th Golden Anniversary sponsor, please take an opportunity, if you haven't yet, to see the Intuitive Planetarium. It is amazing, and it is open here at the Rocket Center. And Logicor is another fine Huntsville company who has been our title sponsor for this year's Pass the Torch series, and we say thank you to them as well. Others who have helped us, Glen Raven Incorporated, based out of North Carolina, has helped provide some support for the digital archives that we're doing, and I think we're close to announcing the podcast that will be available both at WHNT-TV and also at Rocket City Digital Media. Both of those companies are helping us with archiving these Pass the Torch series and available for you to listen to later as well. So we want to say thank you to everyone. Also, where's Jack Stokes and Heidi Collier? They are two folks who help us each and every week and serve on our committees, but they also represent a great number of you in the audience and throughout this community who have helped with your volunteer hours, and we could not have done this without you as well. Our education staff, by Dr. Kay Taylor, Rebecca Hitt, Heather Roden, and April Adcock, and of course, Dr. Deborah Barnhart, we thank you all for your help and support in putting these together. So today, Craig Sumner has brought together a wonderful panel to speak to the Lunar Roving Vehicle, the history of the LRV, how it got to be created in such a short time frame, and then integrated into the Apollo lunar missions. And Craig, you're going to introduce your panelists today, which you'll do a much better job than we will. Craig, I understand, is one of the younger members of this group and was labeled a test subject. That's kind of like when my dad used to ask me to hold the lawnmower cable, right? A test subject for the lunar rover vehicle. No, he's done a lot of things. Come up here and please introduce your panel, and let's give him a warm welcome.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Well, good afternoon. Thank you for coming out today. I think you're going to be excited by what we have to show you. I guess I am the baby of the panel here. The oldest is Gene Cowart, sitting down here at a young age of 95. Most of the others that will be speaking today are in their 80s and pushing 90, so I'll let them talk about that. While the lights are still up, though, I'd like to recognize any of you out there in the audience that worked on the lunar rover. Would you please stand up so we can recognize you? If you worked on the lunar rover, please stand up. We'll get started here in just a minute. I'm going to recognize the project manager for the Lunar Roving Vehicle and the chief engineer with Boeing here in just a minute. Each of our panel members will have an opportunity to introduce themselves and tell what they did on the Lunar Roving Vehicle program. 48 years ago, on Apollo 15, we put a battery-operated vehicle on the moon in extreme temperatures, plus or minus 250 degrees were the design requirements. And we really didn't have any problems. It really performed and exceeded our expectation. So I'm going to acknowledge Sonny Maria, who was our project manager back in the day. Most of these guys weren't but 10 years older than me. And if there's, at the time, 10 or 15 years older than me. And for the young people that are in the room, I've got Tristan Mackey, who's a Boeing intern that's helped put together this presentation you're going to see this afternoon. He's the same age I was when I had my opportunity. You'll hear from me later. But first, I'd like to turn it over to Sonny Maria. If we can get the first slide up here, we'll get our program started. I'd also like you to engage the panelists. If you've got a question you'd like to ask while they're speaking, it's my job to keep us on schedule. So if I move you along a little bit, it's because we're trying to stay within a time constraint. Thank you very much.
Testing.
I have to wait for the yellow light.
Okay, welcome everyone. This is quite an interesting story we have for you today. I want to tell you a little bit about how I got this magnificent job. I arrived as a second lieutenant assigned to Dr. Werner von Braun in 1955, and he gave me the liberty of looking around for where I might want to spend my engineering time. And that didn't last very long before something was on the horizon that he was aware of with the president, namely, we were going to the moon. And it was just during that period of time when a lot of the discussions were going on. And my name came up at that time as a result of a rather mediocre job that I had at the center as a second lieutenant. I guess von Braun's staff found out that I was originally from New York, and one of them came to see me about becoming a liaison man to this company up in New York that was having trouble on the Redstone missile at that time, and wanted to know if I'd be interested in going to New York on these liaison trips. Well, I was just happy to grab that opportunity. So. As a result of that experience, though, which was not anything technically great, but as a result of that experience, Dr. von Braun became aware of my name, at least, and who I was, because I occasionally have to be in a meeting where I reported what I was finding out with this company in New York. Ford Instrument Company, by the way, was the name of the company. And I guess when I got out of service, I realized that I was very interested in propulsion as opposed to what I had been doing at that point. And so I kind of marketed myself to Conrad Dannenberg, who was heading up one of the engine offices at that time. And he invited me to stay and join his group and gave me a tremendous opportunity, which led to a lot of other things downstream. And I mention this because von Braun at that time was very concerned that the age of the Germans that were running things at the Marshall Space Flight Center, which was then Guided Missile Development Division, by the way, and later to become ABMA, he was very concerned that all the leadership in the organization were old Germans, and I heard him say it that way, and he was concerned what was going to happen to their desires to go into space someday and really explore the universe. So there was an opportunity there, and Conrad Dannenberg took me on. And my first job with Conrad Dannenberg was to put together a summary of the technology and propulsion around our country. He was ready to prepare a talk he was giving to the AIAA, or the equivalent of that group at that time. And so I put that together, and frankly, I don't think I did a very good job of it. But it was all new to me, and I did the best I could. And when I gave him the charts that I thought summarized what we knew about it, he didn't say anything other than thank you. And he took those charts, apparently, and unbeknownst to me until later, he used them as is, and he apparently thought enough of them that I became a member of his project office at that point, I guess. So that's where I started this whole career leading up to this car. From that, of course, Dr. Von Braun then knew my name, and it wasn't because of all the great things I did, but I just happened to have occasion to interface with him through Conrad Derenberg. Well, along came the Apollo program, and Von Braun at that time was deeply concerned that we didn't have enough American young people, technical people, that could eventually carry on after all these old Germans died. And he was very concerned about that. And so he was constantly on an attack of trying to find young Americans who maybe had a capability in these areas. Well, because of that experience I had as a liaison officer going up to New York periodically, he had seen me, so he could assimilate the name with some work I was doing. Well, when the Apollo program came on, lo and behold, Von Braun now had a problem. He had a lot of major projects that had to get going right away, and he did not want to pick a bunch of Germans to head them up, because first of all, he was concerned they wouldn't even be alive at the end of those programs. So he was looking for young Americans that he had some confidence in. And my name came up as a proposal among several other second lieutenants that had just gotten out of service. And I was fortunate enough to be named the F-1 engine project manager at that time. Now, this was a $1 billion program in $1960. Today, that's like a $7 billion program. I was 28 years old at the time, as I recall. So I got my real start in project management at that point. Didn't spend a lot of time as a real hands-on engineer, but I was involved in of the administrative and the management of people and groups and whatever. And that apparently qualified me to head this program up. So I spent 7.5 years qualifying the F-1 engine with the contractor Rocketdyne. And after that period of time, I guess the J-2 engine had a problem in flight on one of their missions. It was a double failure of one of the engines in the S-2 stage, and that was a cluster of 5 J-2 engines in there, and one of them had a fire indication, and the controller at Houston during the flight cut the engine. The problem was it was miswired in the instrument unit of the Saturn V, and it cut the wrong engine. It cut a good engine. That's not known to many people, but that's what happened. A good engine was cut because they thought they had a fire on board. So I guess at that point, Von Braun felt like he needed to have a project manager who had some experience to head up the J-2 and get the fixes done on that. So I worked that program for another 2.5 years. So all told, I had about 10 years of experience when, lo and behold, someone thought about a lunar roving vehicle for the moon. And I guess my name came up to Von Braun, and he felt like I had a lot of experience in management and that I could probably handle this. Well, I was on vacation in Canada at the time when I got the call from Von Braun's office. And I tried to turn it down as easily as I could without being too overbearing, but I basically said, you know, I have 10 years of experience in propulsion. I know something about propulsion. I don't know anything about a car, except I drive one, but I sure as heck don't know anything about driving one on the moon. And that was my answer, okay? So I thought that meant that that would be received graciously up in Huntsville here, and that they'd find somebody else for the job.
So, well, Sonny,
I got a call the very next day.
Sonny, can you move us, starting in 69, what you had to do to get this program going over 17 and a half months?
Well, that's where we basically are right now. I got the job, and I couldn't turn it down. And so I came back home from my vacation with my family, and they hadn't had one in 10.5 years. And fortunately, in those days, I had an airplane. I was a pilot and a flight instructor, and I was able to get home pretty fast. We had flown up into Canada. And I came home to pick up the LRV. That's when I found out, oh, I have to say one other thing. One other convincing argument that was given to me to take the job was the fact that I shouldn't be concerned because it was only a 17 and a half month program. We had to have flight hardware delivered to the program, to the Cape in 17 and a half months. We didn't even have a contractor at this point, okay? So that was the challenge. Anyhow, we went to work on it, and a combination of Boeing and General Motors won the competition. And that was a big concern to us to a certain degree, in that the Marshall estimate for the job was like it was a $40 million program and would probably take about 3 or 4 years, although they didn't try to identify the time, but they had an estimate for the job. Well, when we put it out for bid, the lowest bid on it was the Boeing General Motors combination. The others were all much higher than that, and the government's estimate at that time was much higher than the contractor's estimate. But nevertheless, Boeing got the job. And there's a young man sitting way down front here who was chief engineer for Boeing, and I'm sure he'll stand up one of these days and everyone can clap for him. Because without this man, we wouldn't have gotten the car for the moon.
Get up. You can if you want to. Or you can stay there.
You can sit there, yep.
Well, I wish I could have designed these seats.
All right. He deserves every one of your claps,
well,
believe
me. I got to hold this way, huh? Well, I'm only 39, but I worked on this thing. And they said it's got about 18 months here to get it done. And I told him that's too short. And he looked right straight at me and said, well, make it happen. And at any rate, we took off. And it were those 18-month programs where if I got the funny paper read Sunday morning, that was a real victory.
How about it, Chief?
That's even better.
Yeah. I feel better. All right.
Oh, I could go all day now. Sonny, you through? You're just going to...
I'm almost done.
Well, this program, as you will see up here at NASA, had been doing an enormous amount of research and get ready for this. They didn't just get up some morning and say, well, let's make a rover. So, and you'll see there's an awful lot of work done in the laboratories with NASA people doing this thing, proving all of how do we do this thing, how they got to the point of putting a proposal out. And I didn't work on the proposal since I tried to avoid those always. And at any rate, they got it. They did win the thing. And in time, I got assigned to it. And it was a get it thing. And of course, in working on this, you realize that you've got all of this stuff, but you've got to get it assembled into one piece. And there's a lot of research work done. And you had to, I wouldn't say commercialize, but you did have to put them where you could procure that type thing or build it. And we did some of both. And of course, while you're doing this and you're really going gung ho on it, a lot of funny things happen. I don't know why I can remember them, but one of them was we tried to make the weight thing, and we never quite made as low as we wanted it, quite a bit below. But I thought, well, what's the problem there anyway? This thing must lift a little rover, the Saturn V. And so, well, that's not the problem. It'll lose a dozen Saturn V rovers. But once it gets on the moon's surface, the lunar excursion module is going to break apart, not break up, but take off, and that's coming down on the moon's surface so that they will have to have some time on their propulsion liquids to surface around and find a spot to land. Because when it comes down, it must be either level or not more than 14 and a half degrees off center, or it won't come out, the rover won't come out, and they won't come back to the moon from the moon because it's going to lift off. Well, that was one of them there that we went. At any rate, trying to get weight, Boeing came up with a thing, everybody get a $25 savings bond if you had a suggestion accepted. Well, that's $18.75, and that meant something to some of us. But as chief engineer, I did have to write a little note back to people why something wasn't right and wasn't going to work and that type of thing. However, we got a very senior vice president that got into it, and we were bombarded with his suggestions, countless suggestions from him. And my immediate big boss didn't want to write him and say, you write him and tell him why not. So I got pretty good at that, because we had to, you know, keep feathers smooth, and that worked. Of course, the $25 savings bond was, I guess it was in the contract. Sonny, maybe you paid for it. I don't know.
We probably did. But that's why we overran.
Among the funny things that did happen, though, we had a display. The thing was designed to unwind. One time it was going to come out like a switchblade knife. But at any rate, we had a display of that to do that. We set it up over there in the Hick Building, I believe. And at the last minute, somebody says, this is supposed to be on the moon's surface, so you can display this. Okay, we'll be as real as possible. And a word then used was suited subject, meaning this is astronaut. He was going to come out over the door on the lunar excursion module and pull the lever and the thing would come out. Well, Dr. Reese, the center director, was there with all of his helpers. And at the last minute, somebody said, you'll have moon dust everywhere. So we sent downtown and got about 25 pounds of very cheap noxious talcum powder. And we threw it all over everything, see, so that when it opens up, you can see this cloud. Okay. Well, that worked pretty good. People said, what terrible smell. It's cheap stuff anyway. But and you paid for that too. But any rate, when he stepped out and pulled the lever, it came halfway out in a big crack, see. It never fails. And Dr. Reese, and I have an accent, but Dr. Reese had one too. And he said, I didn't think it was going to work like that. Well, all of his helpers immediately said no. And as a matter of fact, I think NASA did change that design to one that could unwind, which worked pretty good until they got on the moon's surface, so we didn't get to see it come out. Because somebody said the astronaut fell down holding the camera. I don't know. We didn't see that movie on the first one. That and the some of the other things that happened. The thing called unknowns. It's an unknown unknown. That's something you didn't know till you got into it, and then you had to improvise or try to figure to get out of this. And we had a lot of that. And of course, we were working hand in glove with NASA all this time. And I will mention one guy, my counterpart, who passed away, was Jim Sisson, who was a very good engineer, NASA. And I enjoyed working with him and all the others, actually. But it was a day and night proposition to get it done. And we did finally complete the thing. But as I say, I'm only 39 and I worked on that, so. That's why I look like this. But anyway, I could have more stories, but I just seem to remember some of the funny stuff, and there's a lot of it in there. But any rate, thank you. Enjoyed it.
Thank you again. Thank you again. Okay, the other comment I wanted to make is one of the things that I learned in this whole program, and it came out of Von Braun again, and that is that it was a work ethic that not only rubbed off on us that worked for him, but also the contractors that worked for us. And that work ethic was you off to bed late, early to rise, work like hell, and advertise. And that was a work ethic that we all kind of worked to, as I recall, and still do today. Okay. Well, I don't think I have much more to say.
That's good. If you'll pass your microphone back to Skeet right behind you. Oh. And Skeet Vaughn will be our next panel presenter.
Oh. Well, anyway, I might. my job at Marshall was to mainly provide a design criteria document so they could actually build the rover. So I had to come up with lunar surface operations models. But I came here to Huntsville in 1956 to work for the Army Ballistic Missile Agency, and about 80% of us transferred into NASA in 1960, Marshall Space Flight Center. And for a couple of years now, I didn't work on anything like a moon or anything like that. I worked on as a project engineer for the Atlas Agena and Atlas Centaur missions for a while. And then they transferred my whole program up to Lewis Research Lab. And they sent me up there in December, and there was 12 foot of snow on the ground when I got up there. And I said, I'm not staying up here. I'm coming back to Huntsville to get a new job. So I came back to Huntsville to get a new job and looked around and run into a fellow named William W. Vaughn, who was in charge of the Aerospace Environment Division at that point. And I asked him if he had a job for me, and he said he needed someone to do some design stuff on the lunar surface operations. So I became a lunar expert at that point, basically by just reading about the moon and talking to the people at the university, at the Geological Survey in Flagstaff, the Astronomical Geological Survey in Flagstaff, and also working with the people at JPL and the surveyor program. And that was one of the most important things we did in the Apollo program, is the surveyor program, I think, because we actually landed 5 surveyors on the moon, actually, and we got a lot of information about the lunar surface materials, the characteristics, soil, surface roughness, that. And so that's the surveyor program right there. That shows you on the left up there, the surveyor pad on the moon surface. On the right is the actual lunar simulated soil materials that we use to test the rover wheels in to get the idea of how much power is required to pull that vehicle through that soil. The soil is a very interesting material. I have a sample here I'll show you. What's interesting about it is the fact that it's fine-grained basalt material, a volcanic rock, ground up exactly to the specifications that we found on the lunar surface operations. When we first did the surveyor, the first surveyor landed successfully. The second surveyor actually had a scoop on it, so we could actually dig through the soil. And by digging through the soil, we found that when you dug with the soil with a scoop, it made a vertical wall. Well, they were trying to figure out what the vertical wall was, why it was there, and we figured, well, it's because the lunar vacuum means that all these particles can stick real close together. So we were trying to come up with a process material that we could actually develop for use in the design of the rover power requirements. And this is the material. It's funny, the material soil, if you take a bucket of sand and pour it out, it has an angle of friction of about 27 degrees. If you take this stuff here and rotate it 90 degrees, it has an angle of repose of about 88 degrees. I'll show you. Here's a good example. Rotate it full until it finally goes, finally collapses. So we knew that lunar soil has a lot of strength. And you got to remember, too, that this sample has air in it as well between the grains. So the fact you have air there lubricates the grains, but we still have an awful lot of strength. So we knew the moon's surface had a lot of surface, a lot of strength. We were more worried about the contamination of the suits and everything from the dust materials we had on the moon. And this was a surveyor program here with all the equipment on it. We had 5 surveyors, like I said, landed successfully on the moon. We actually had 1 surveyor, Surveyor 3, which actually landed in a crater. And on the Apollo program, that mission, Apollo 12, that was Bean and Conrad, and they went to the moon and actually brought the camera back from the surveyor, which I had suggested in 1967 to do. Can we have the next slide? The next slide shows the concept of where the wheel came from. The first concept on the left side is the original concept by a guy named Thomas Ricketts in England in 1857. He came up with an idea called a metal elastic tire. And that tire was going to be used in a small transporter vehicle that he would develop, and he actually got a patent in 1859 on it. So what happened was, as I say, we brought the moon wheel back to the Earth from his concept, and we actually built a prototype wheel. The prototype wheel you see right here in the lower right side. And when Boeing came in and made their contract proposal pitch to Marshall, this guy named Vern Pavlik's right here. He's the guy, there's the engineer that came up with the idea of the wheel design for the rover, because he'd done an awful lot of studies in the early surveyor program about it. The early surveyor program, the JPL was going to land an unmanned rover on the moon. So General Motors had done an awful lot of work on how to build this rover, this foldable rover concept. So Pravix brought this little vehicle, a Model N, to the office of Von Braun and drove it in for remote control. And Von Braun said, "What's that?" And he said, "Well, maybe you ought to go with you guys because you're further along than anybody else." And that's one of the main reasons I think that Boeing wanted the contract, because this concept right here. One more slide, I think. Yeah, okay, this shows you the data we got from the surveyor was very good, but the most important data we got was from the Lunar Orbiter spacecraft program, Lunar Orbiter. And Lunar Orbiter was the one that gave us the 1 meter resolution photography of the lunar surface operation. From that, we could actually develop a model, a lunar driving simulator terrain model, which you've seen in the section, the map and the model there. And that's Craig over there driving the simulator that we came up with. So we trained the astronaut to drive on the moon. Upper right corner, it shows how the TV camera showed. So we had a little device that ran across the map and had a little TV camera in the front of it. And so we could actually simulate what the astronaut was seeing as he drove on the moon. So it was very useful for the astronauts to learn how to drive on the moon. Yeah. And I think that's my last slide, right?
I'm going to try to pick up the pace here a little bit. I wasn't about to tell our senior panel members that was very interesting to listen to all three of you, that's for sure. I was 21 years old co-oping at the University of West Florida down in Pensacola and came up to the Marshall Space Flight Center for 3 months at a time. Let me have the next slide. 3 months at a time. One time I got so involved in this program, they asked me if I could stay six. So a minute ago, you saw this picture in Skeets. This is the actual 6 degree of freedom movable base simulator that we had down in 4663 in the comp lab. When that was energized after the astronauts and test subjects came up the ladder, you're sitting up here in an LRV environment that changed over time. This was a shirt sleeve environment, as you see right here. I got so involved that even during my school week, as a 21-year-old, I'd fly in the back seat of a military training aircraft, come up here to Redstone Arsenal, and just had the time of my life working on the LRV program. Can I have the next slide? So here I am. I got to do a lot of suited work, mainly working on the hand controller. You know, most pilots are used to pistol grips, and what we got here in this picture is what they're kind of used to in aircraft. But after I drive for about an hour, it'd bring blood to my wrist. And we brought the next group that you're going to be listening to, are some of our crew systems people in from the Marshall Space Flight Center, to help redesign this into a T-handle that when you got a glove on that's got a ring in it, it was real easy now to make a left and right hand turn. The suits that I used to wear and some of the other folks that are in this room was Buzz Aldrin's training suit, Jim Lovell from Apollo 13, or Tom Hanks, whichever name you might remember there. And it's pretty impressive to wear something that cost $175,000 back in the day. Before I met my wife of 45 years, I weighed 145 pounds. By the time I got my suit on and my backpack, I weighed 350. Today, I weigh the same with just the suit on. She's that good. Here's some of the things we went through. That map that you saw a minute ago that drove with four little Teflon balls across the surface was built by Heinz Lauser. I was his co-op student. I was everybody's co-op student. Building that map by taking a blowtorch, burning holes in it, and then putting the fire out with nitrogen when we finally achieved the surface area that we were really trying to duplicate. I can't remember everything that was on this suit, but somehow we got wired up. We got air conditioning. It's the smallest room I've ever been in. You can't scratch your ears. You can't scratch your nose. There's a lot of things you can't do in that suit during an 8 hour period of time. Or if you do, it'll be there 8 hours later too. Here's the other hand controller that we eventually got to, just to show you the personality of the commander that sits in the left seat. He wanted that thing turned 10 degrees towards him. That was his vehicle. Next slide. So when the Lunar Rover program was over, so was my draft deferment. And just real short, I managed to achieve what some of the other, if you got a Lunar Rover vehicle driver's license, raise your hand. I see a couple hands coming up in here. What a privilege it was to have that. So I went off and flew a few airplanes that the astronauts would tell me about in the drive from Redstone Airfield
over to the simulation facility with people like Dave Scott and Jim Irwin, saying if you hadn't cut me off at 10,000 feet, I would have landed first. 21-year-old looking at him and going, you guys are going to the moon. They were so competitive in everything that they did. And their stories that I learned over that short period of time have stayed with me a lifetime. Next slide. All right, Jack.
Well, I think you've about heard everything that that I wanted to share with you, except that my time was also with the sixth off, and even earlier than that, when we just had a fixed platform, and our suits were very early Apollo suits, as you can see in the picture, they're a very early type of suit. The suit on the right, this is a Bendix vehicle. We actually drove this out in a field behind building 4619. That suit was the RX-3 built by Litton. It's a hard suit. It was a very interesting suit. The one on the left is much like a balloon, and so when you move your arms and legs, you actually change the pressure in the suit. But with a hard suit, you can move your arms and legs, and it does not change your pressure, but your motions are really weird, because it's kind of a rolled-type arm or rolled-type leg. Several of us in the human factors engineering group were fortunate enough to serve as test subjects on this Bendix vehicle. We had been working, as you saw, with the 6th degree of freedom simulator, but we thought we needed to move on to something else. And so we called the Army next door, and we asked if the demolition guys could come over and put some dynamite in the ground, blow us some holes. And so we were able to create a lunar surface rather quickly. And so then we drove this vehicle around to see how it would do as it went down into craters and back out. My time with the Lunar Rover program ended before we got to the Boeing version, and so this is, I guess, my claim to fame.
Okay, John, I was going to give you a chance to say a few words, too, and your role in the Lunar Rover program.
Well, I was a psychologist, you know, this has to be the strangest person on the arsenal at the time, but I was hired just months after the Apollo fire, and specifically tasked by Von Braun to keep the guys safe, as we all were, but specifically in our human factors analysis. But anyway, Jack mentioned our course. We had prototype vehicles come in, and we had to test them, and we tried to put it out on contract, and of course, it was too much money, so we couldn't afford to put it out on contract, so we did it in-house. Skeet was involved with that, Jack, and probably several others in the room. But I went over to the Army, and I said, we need some holes in the ground. Can you guys make holes? They said, what do you want? And I told them, Skeet told me a potential landing site, so we knew the test course we wanted, and I handed them this map, and they said, oh, yeah, we can do that. We can make any kind of hole you want. Skeet can tell you how they did it. But anyway, then we had a trailer vehicle trying to follow to do the telemetry, and they catch the data from the guys that were driving them, and it was getting stuck. So we had to go back to the Army and say, hey, you have vehicles that don't get stuck. Can we borrow one of your vehicles that doesn't get stuck? And so little money transferred between NASA and the Army to blow up some holes and to provide us with a trailer vehicle, and we did our test. And the 6th degree of freedom, I'll tell you, the astronauts were very impressed with that, because I designed the study examining those hand controllers, and we saw those problems that they were having that you indicated there. And so we were hard at work. I had a hallucination about restoring an old boat when I got here. And my boat was at the same marina Von Braun's was, where he would have his houseboat. He'd go out to Snake Island with his kids sometimes on the weekend. And when he would spot me, you can guess what happened.
My name is Steve Hall, and before I forget it, I want to mention one more thing about the hard suit that Jack Stokes alluded to. I worked real closely with Jack and also Dick Heckman. Spent a lot of time in the simulator, And I did go out to the test area that Jack alluded to. The hard suit that he showed was not exactly built for someone like me. I have a 28-inch inseam, and it had legs on it that were considerably longer. And when I put the suit on, they had to lay me down in the back end of a pickup truck, drive me out to the test site, pick me up, and put me in the seat, because there's no way in the world I could have walked in that suit. Anyhow, I went to Purdue University and graduated in 1968, graduated on June 9th. The following morning, I got my degree at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The next morning, 8 o'clock, I reported at work at NASA. Had a great time, specifically on the Lunar Orbiting Vehicle Program. Was involved in a lot of the simulations, both in the site that Jack mentioned and also in the 6 Degree of Freedom simulator. And Craig had already mentioned the business of redesigning the hand controller to a T-bar arrangement rather than using a pistol grip. There were several of us that had problems with that because it affected our wrists. And the program was so fast-paced, it was amazing that they changed the diameter of the wrist ring in the suit, the articulation of the shoulder, as well as that pistol grip hand controller, so that it solved that problem. And getting a suit qualified with a bunch of changes like that, in addition to coming up with a rover, was a tremendous accomplishment itself. When we're driving the lunar roving vehicle, one of the favorite things to do, and we had a test run with a 6 Degree of Freedom simulator, if we had a real good test run, the test conductor would allow us to zip down into a simulated crater and fly out the other side. And you could feel the vehicle leaving the surface, and it would soar for a short while. And the only way you could tell that you were off the surface was there'd be a sharp jerk when you landed on the surface. And several months after we did our simulations, the astronauts experienced the same thing on the moon. So it was a very good simulation. Also worked on the deployment system for the lunar roving vehicle. Let's have the next chart. And on the left-hand side, you see a shot of Lee Weaver and myself going through one of the deployment simulations. One of the most important technologies that they harnessed, I guess, in coming up with the rover was they crammed that little vehicle in a compartment that was roughly the size of a one-man pup tent. And if you were to take that pup tent and approach the triangular face on it and lift that face up, that was sort of the way the rover was packed into the vehicle. It was crammed into a little cranny in the descent stage of the rover. And there was a pretty complex system that you used to deploy it. Operations started out by taking a couple of tapes or cables and spreading them out on either side where the rover would end up on the ground. And then you went up to the ladder and pulled a handle and released it. And this is a simulation that shows it coming down. The back end of the vehicle is the first part to touch the ground. It was very highly articulated. There were a bunch of pins that got pulled out by springs. And if things didn't go right, you could get that cable tangled up. And I'll say more about that in just a second. But here you see it lowered to the surface, and the wheels are going to pop out. And again, we're looking at the back end of the vehicle right there. There go the back wheels, popped out. And the chassis was built in three parts. What you just saw fly out was the rear chassis. There's a center chassis, which was the base was on the outside of the vehicle when it landed and provided some protection. A big box in the center is the control panel. And there was a telescoping sliding piece that sort of allowed the vehicle to come out on the surface. And you'll see the forward chassis pop out in just a second, and the wheels come around and get in position. And there we go. And one of the first things you did when this thing got on the surface was you had to go around, you had to check to make sure that all the latches were engaged, because you wouldn't want to hop on that thing and have it fall flat on the surface. And another thing, too, we talked earlier about the surface having certain angular requirements and so forth. If it wasn't on a flat enough surface, that deployment system would bind up and you'd have to tug on it. And in fact, the first mission, I guess it did have to jiggle around a little bit to disengage it completely from the vehicle.
That's Charlie Duke over there on the left.
On the left-hand side, bringing the back wheels down to the surface.
And Bob Parker, an astronaut, was with him that day.
And I started, the contract, I guess, for the LRV was let about 18 months after I started working at NASA. And 18 months after that, Dave Scott was driving the rover around on the moon. So I was very fortunate to be involved in a project with that sort of timing. And one of the things I had a little challenge with was establishing credibility, since I was fresh out of college. But when we had problems with one of the cables getting stuck in the deployment mechanism, we used a tool as a backup to take care of that problem, and it flew along with the vehicle. During one of the simulations, we bent that tool, and a few days later, down at the Cape, the astronauts did the same thing, and it was very encouraging to have them experience some of the same things we did, and did a lot toward proving our value of our simulations. I think that's about all I have to say right now. It was one fun vehicle to drive. It handled a lot like a go-kart on ice, if you can imagine that.
You know, the simulations that we had used analog and digital computers, but one amongst us here did hand calculations. I'll let Wayne give his background on the lunar roving vehicle.
Well, I was in the Hick building, I think, on the fifth floor. On the fifth floor under Gene over here. And I used the slide rule because at that time you didn't have computers set up, or it took as long to get the computer set up as I had time to put out the monthly report. And so I think we did about seven or eight. There's a slide rule. They didn't require batteries or anything. And I don't know who invented them. I think the Chinese. But that way we got it out on time and pretty much built our confidence that we were on the right track.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. Ron Creel worked on the Lunar Roving Vehicle Program. He's going to tie all of this together from everything that you've heard so far. He's got some really neat slides to show you. I'm not sure who that young guy is up there in the picture.
Yeah, who's that mustache guy? And by the way, I wanted to mention in the previous movie, that was A.P. Warren with the mustache. And he was an excellent engineer. And we cherish the memory of A.P. He couldn't come to our 40th reunion back in 2011. I don't know if he's still alive or not. And in fact, I would say I really appreciate seeing a lot of the people here, but a lot of them have gone. And it's just the fact of life. If they talk about me, for Wayne, I brought my little slide rule. This was actually distributed in the supply room in building 4610. So I still kept this. It's 50 years old. And it was more handy than the log ones. Anyway, that's me at the console. By the way, we progressed from slide rules to computers, but we didn't have laptops. This was our laptop, in a way, was a teletype that was hooked into a computer, and Larry Taormino at CompLab, I've tried to contact him, he actually programmed it such that this is the room where they monitored the Saturn V in the hospital building, Huntsville Operations Support Center, in building 4663. And we took over that room after the Saturn V was launched and went in there. And here you can see his computer program processed our thermal model as well as the signals from Houston, the TV picture from Houston. Quickly, I mentioned to y'all, I started in 65 also as a co-op. We had a lot of co-ops, didn't we? They call them interns now. We don't use the term co-op. And I worked on the Saturn V. I worked with Lynn Worland on Pogo on the S1C stage of the Saturn V, and worked up here on the S4B stage with Leon Hastings. We built little plastic models, put liquid in there, put them in the drop tower out there in the big dynamic stand you see out there at Marshall. And we drop it and put thrusters on there, raise the package up, got about 4 seconds of low gravity, and worked out how the baffles would work in the upper stage, such that you don't want to make sure that the liquid was seated down inside the tank when you went ready to ignite the stage to go out to the moon. That's what we worked on. Well, that's enough to talk about the Saturn V. But the Saturn V is important because it carried the lunar module, as you see here. This is the lander, and we used, as people pointed out before, this was the pie-shaped section that was devoted then to the rover. They gave up some propellant to go to the moon. The rover started out, was supposed to weigh about 400 pounds. They actually weighed about 462 with the rover itself, and then you add equipment for deploying it, as Lee showed. And so we got it. I wanted to show this picture here because you got to realize when you had the, we had two silver zinc batteries, weighed about 60 pounds each. The two batteries were set in this opening here. The floor panel's been removed, and this is, the floor panel was put back on. It was stacked in the lunar, inside the Saturn V, and then that whole assembly went out to launch pad. That was probably 2 or 3 weeks ahead of launch. So then the crew, the technicians, had to climb through this gantry. See this second gantry down? This is the crew gantry to go into the command module. This second gantry went to a door inside the SLAW panel, the launch adapter, and they actually go inside about 2 days before the mission and actually install the batteries, seal up the insulation, then put the floor panel back on, then come back out. They did monitor the temperatures, and they called us up one time, I remember on a, I think it was Apollo 16, and they said, hey, the battery's supposed to be 70 plus or minus 5 degrees at launch, and they were about 80 to 85. They called us up and they said, hey, we're exceeding the mission rule. There was no way, Hugh Campbell was my senior mentor, there's no way we're going to have them stop a Saturn V. It's fueled, it's ready to go, and we're going to stop it because the battery's 5 degrees hotter. So we say, Hugh said, go for it. So we did launch. Let's go to the next page. Try to get y'all through this, then you can ask some questions. I wanted to show y'all how the rover was folded up. This is a simulation done by my associate up in Ottawa, Canada. This is the same software that's used for the Lightwave program for Star Wars. It's a polygon model, and it shows you the process for folding the rover, and I think it's very good to give you a feeling for how the rover was folded up. And I want to point out here, these fender extensions are very important. You're going to see them come into play here as what happens. The fender extensions had to be on there such that they would slide back and the wheels could touch, well, they didn't actually touch each other, but it gave you so the fenders could fit, these fender extensions. And you're going to see that the fender extensions are going to be a problem later on. It was our major issue on the moon. But we tried. And let's go to the next chart. Okay, going to the moon. I want to point out, first of all, that we were totally passive with a little interaction of the astronauts you're going to see about in a little bit, but we were totally passive thermal control with a 10-pound budget, 10 pounds out of that 460 for thermal control. As such, there was no telemetry and thermal testing of the stowed configuration, but good modeling by the folks at Boeing, that's Monroe Britt, who did the modeling of that and proved that the vehicle would go. Now let's click on the assembly. The assembly here has come out of the third stage. The command and service module have docked with the lunar module, and now it goes through a rotation. This rotation is actually speeded up in time. It was about 3 revolutions per hour. It's balancing out the solar heating with the radiation of all these components to space. And there's the rover. There's the rover folded up inside that lunar module. That's how it flew to the moon. It took about 3 days to get there. And we could go back now. And this is the whole sequence here. And people often ask me, say, why didn't we bring the rovers back? They don't understand mass balance, that you have to carry enough propellant to get you off the moon with that extra weight on it to get you back. No, the rovers were left on the moon, 3 rovers up on the moon, Apollo 15, 16, and 17. I brought the globe here. My wife bought this for me to give lectures to students. And I've got on here the locations of the 6 landings and the locations of the 3 rovers on here, if y'all want to examine this later on. So pass this around and walk, okay? It shows the 3 rovers. We launched, the Apollo 15 was the farthest to the north, Apollo 16 was the farthest to the south, and the Apollo 17 was the farthest to the east. The other missions were the farthest to the west, Apollo 11 and 12 and 14. Okay, next chart. Okay. We had another concern was about thrusters on the way to the moon and landing. And that was the thrusters on the lunar module. You'll see these shields were made up. They actually tested these up at Grumman in New York. and tested it for us. And we also had, thank heavens for Velcro. We had this shield that was added down here at the bottom to protect us from the main thrust of this engine, about a 20,000-pound thrust engine for landing on the moon. This is the ascent stage. This is the descent stage with the rover on board. And thank goodness they had Velcro so the astronauts could lower the Velcro. You want to go ahead and show the, you show the scale down, the skeleton model of the deployment. This one's done by the same fellow in Canada that shows the... it got a little bit quicker than it really worked, but it still shows you a little bit better detail on the deployment. And but that story you had, Gene, about the unfolding at the Hick Building, I've heard that too, that Willie Prostoffer came into Roy Runkel, and he said after that occurrence happened where it fell onto the ground in the Hick Building, he says, Werner has called. Werner says, we will fix this. And they did fix it. I was actually up in Kent, Washington, a suburb of Seattle, the day that they actually got the first successful deployment of the rover. They used a 1/6 gravity simulator. And you see how it comes out. Yep. Next chart. Okay. Now, let's talk about the rovers once we got to the moon. How do we thermally control? How do we keep components within their temperature limits? We were there in the mornings. Now, the mornings were not just for the rover. The mornings were for the lunar module, for the astronauts. And it was all sequenced such that if you missed the launch window, you'd slip a month because you had to time yourself such that you got there only in that time period of the lunar morning. And as such, we did know that we were concerned about have to deal with dust. I want to point out though that we had a requirement to maintain all surfaces within the astronaut touch constraints, which it's meant that we made a lot of things white. You'll see a lot of white surfaces, white command console, white astronaut suits, white backpack, white aft pallet. That was to keep the solar absorptance down, and even though we're ultimately going to get dust on there, I'm going to tell you about that, and it violated that. But that was the intent. Mobility system, we knew it was going to be exterior dust coverage. We had hermetically sealed motor and drive systems, 1/4 horsepower DC motor in each of the four wheels, and a harmonic drive in each one of those wheel assemblies. And it was hermetically sealed such that we couldn't get dust in there. Never had a problem with the motor systems. I'll tell you a little story, a little anecdote about the testing about that in a little bit. But you notice the stripes on the side? That was to try to get some information about the relative motion of the wheel with respect to the chassis. And you can see that in the video that you saw before. And that was the intent of that striping. Now, I want to show you John Nickram. Now, John Nickram has helped us out a lot, and E.C. Smith worked the navigation system, and it was very unique. Let's go ahead and click on this device. I can just explain. People would wonder, how did you know where you were on the moon? How did you know where were you with respect to the lunar module? It was very important to know where your home base is. And what you see here is, this is an animation of lifting the sun shadow device. The sun shadow device cast a shadow on this little dial here. That gave you the yaw angle of the sun. You park down sun, you got the sun angle. We had the sun there. We didn't have GPS satellites like you got here on Earth. We had no satellites in orbit. Well, you had the command and service module was up there, but he wasn't there constantly. Not like you got, when you got the GPS system, you're working off about 20, 21 satellites at one time, averaging the position out. We didn't have that on the moon, but we had the sun. So we used that for yaw. Then you had a little pitch and roll indicator over here. You could get pitch angle. They read that out to Houston. And then you turned it around, and you could get the roll angle. So you had the three angles you needed. Then in this operations handbook, which y'all are welcome to look at, the people in Houston had a section in the operations handbook where they had curves in there take those measurements, and then you can interpolate here and determine where you're going to torque the gyro to set the initial position of yourself at the lunar module when they initialize the rover system. And you always want to know where you were with respect to the lunar module, because that's home base.
And hey, Ron, can I add one thing?
Yep.
The astronauts would get driving along. They're in a new area, and all of a sudden there'd be boulders in front of them and boulders out to the side, and they'd stop. We didn't give them rear view mirrors. You can't turn around in that suit.
No, that's right.
And they'd undo their Velcro seat belts and turn around and go back out the way they came in. John Young told me that was not rocket science. That was common sense. So in addition to all that sophistication, they could just follow their way back to the limb or find the shortest way with what Ron just got through describing to you.
Right. And by the way, that navigation system was so accurate that on all three missions, when they got back to lunar module after driving around for several hours, the error was less than a tenth of a kilometer, which is about the length of a football field, out of driving 20-25 miles at a time. And I wanted to show you all here, for thermal control, our main, as I told you, we had two batteries and a computer up front and a gyroscope and a drive control electronics box. Let's go to this picture here and I can explain better. This is the forward assembly where you'll see the dust covers. We knew there was going to be dust, and see when you stop it there, Tristan. When it gets up, the astronauts would open the covers after a driving period for the cool down period. There you go. Oh, you got to catch it. Got to catch it. Look right at some, because I want to show people the radiators. There you go. There you go. That's good. That's good catch. You see the four radiators? These are space radiators. They're little second surface mirrors. Here's a battery. This is a battery. This is the radiator on the signal processing unit, the main navigation computer. This is the wax tank on top of the drive control electronics. There was another wax tank under here with a thermal strap from the computer into this battery, and another thermal strap over here. That was our 10-pound budget, was the wax boxes and the thermal straps to strap to move the heat. Now we have, on a spacecraft now, you have hundreds of heat pipes. We didn't have heat pipes back in that day. Plus, we didn't have the weight to have them anyway. So people, we were working with the best we could do. And they worked fairly well. In fact, on Apollo 15, Dave Scott tells that that's the only time that we got, there was a mechanism, by the way, on the side here. You were worried that if you overcooled, you didn't want to overcool. So there was a bimetallic spring on each one of the batteries, such that when it got to 50 degrees Fahrenheit, the covers would close. Well, we only ever had one cover close on all three missions. That was this big cover over here. And that was because Dave Scott said there was no dust on the radiators, and he didn't try to brush it. Because I'm going to tell you, the brush was the culprit when you get down to it. I'll tell you about that. So let's go on. Next chart. I think I've talked pretty much about everything on here. Now then, it was very important for us with these computer models to correlate the thermal vacuum test data that we had with those thermal models. And I'll start here with, here's an assembly and a special tub to simulate the lunar surface with the battery covers open. This whole tub assembly with the forward chassis assembly was put inside the same chamber we're going to talk about the mobility testing. Okay, and as you can see, we got good correlation for the test data versus the analytical, and that meant that we could use that thermal model for other excursions where you're driving longer periods of time and even where you've got dust on the radiators. Let's go ahead and show this movie up here, Tristan. This is the mobility testing, which you've already seen some of. It goes into a little bit about the thermal testing. It's got audio. What he says is, I wish we had the audio. It's not that audio. The motor's on a treadmill, all of that with bump stops on there, that was put up inside that vacuum chamber. And this is torture testing, which you saw a little bit as you came in. This is torture testing. Never had a wire breakage on any of the 12 tires, wire mesh tires on the moon. And even, I think they may have lost one or two chevrons, titanium chevrons were on there for tread. But wheels work great, And I want to tell you one anecdote. Let's see the torture testing. They really put it through its paces. For that testing me being a young whippersnapper, I was only about 24 or 25 at that time. Here I am over here by the test assembly. We came to a night where we're going to have the longest driving period. And these technicians, they kind of viewed me as being the young whippersnapper from NASA. He doesn't really know what he's doing. Okay, so they knew it was going to be a long time. They're going to be the longest drive time. Going to be the hottest temperature. They said, "Okay, Mr. Wise Guy." They didn't say it that way. "Okay, Mr. Creel, what's the maximum temperature going to be?" I said 254 degrees. Went off to dinner. Came back. Okay, I'm looking around, and it's mum. I said, what was the temperature? Nobody will tell me what the temperature was. So I went over to the trip charts, you know, pulled it out. I said, 253. I was off a degree. They never gave me any trouble after that. They said, wait a minute, this guy must know something about it. I had already run some models, so I knew. And by the way, that 254, that's very close to, on the moon, on Apollo 17, they did get to 270 on the longest drive. But that was well below the 400 degree limit, well below. So the mobility system never gave us an issue. Batteries, not so. I wanted to start in and tell y'all about the dust. Dust was our main concern on the moon, and it did affect us. I'm very proud here that Ken Riggs and John Reeves helped him. They maintained a program here. There were managers that wanted to save weight and wanted to get rid of the fenders. That's how weight critical they were. So Ken Riggs, he sponsored this testing in the KC-135, the Vomit Comet, where they actually put inside a vacuum chamber, inside the airplane. Here's the vacuum chamber. Inside, here's the pressurization system. Inside the KC-135 with a lazy Susan with soil in it, with a wheel rotating around, driving inside the KC-135, showed that, hey, we better keep the fenders. A separate testing, which still I try to point out to people, be very, very careful then when you're doing any kind of soil testing here on the Earth. It works differently up there on the moon. People that theorize about having moving the dust with electric magnetics and things and all, be very careful, guys. I mean, we proved here. We had done, with even using Apollo 12 dust put on radiators in separate little vacuum chambers, we showed here on the Earth that you could actually clean them with that dust brush. It didn't work that way on the moon. So I keep telling that to people, and whether they'll listen or not, I don't know. But we learned, and people would say, well, if you knew that, well, Apollo 15, we started beginning to see that we were not getting the cool down in between EVAs. Apollo 16, let's talk about what happened on 16. 16, John Young, the commander, he had a hammer in his suit, in his leg of his suit. He caught that hammer under the fender extension and popped it off. Let's go back to that one, Trent. I'm not quite through with that one yet. I'll get to the other fix. But Apollo 16, he knocked the fender extension off. So we went about redesigning it, and Gene may remember that. Redesigned the fender extension, did thermal vac tests. Even had, in Houston, they have a chamber that's astronaut qualified. We set that up in there. Astronaut came in. He deployed the fender. It worked great. The fender fixed, well, what we thought the fix was. However, now I want to mention one thing. Before I leave the star, I want to show y'all. This is in the big chamber in Kent, Washington, which I think has been taken down now after all these years. This is a full-up rover. Qualification unit and the flight units were put on a 30-degree incline in a fixture with dynamometers under each wheel to match the wheel speed and tested. We even put special covers, special black plates on some of the components to simulate dust coverage. And we put the qualification unit through much, much more demanding missions than we ever flew on the moon. And we had what we call acceptance testing on the flight units, which was a shorter duration testing. Now then, let's go up to Apollo 17. One other anecdote. I was talking to Dave Arnett down here in the front row. And after Apollo 16, and we'd done all this testing, and we even took a full-up rover, the qual unit, over to the Army test facility because we had some switches didn't work during a power-up of Apollo 16. We tested at minus 30 degrees Fahrenheit, and as you would probably expect, we never duplicated what happened on the moon on Apollo 16. But by the way, those meters did come on later on in the mission. They were probably just too cold from a down sun parking. Okay, Dave Ardette and I were called down to the Cape Kennedy to the astronaut crew quarters. He had to make sure he didn't have any sneezes or sniffles or anything. But we went in there, and we told him about what testing had been done, all the things we'd done to try to get him cover. Now, this, by the way, the backup crew was the Apollo 16 astronauts, and the flight crew was the Apollo 17. So here we are a couple of nights before the mission talking to them about what happened about after the exploration on Apollo 16, and then tried to counsel with Gene Cernan, the commander on Apollo 17, to do a little bit better job of cleaning off the covers before you opened up the dust covers. which he really did. We got some better cool downs on Apollo 17. Okay, but I was telling Dave, it didn't strike me until I got in the airplane coming back home. My God, I've been here in the room, as close as this, talking to two men that had been to the moon, drove around the moon, and the two that were going a couple of nights. That kind of hit me as, I'll never have an opportunity like that again. These guys were real heroes when you think about it. To go 240,000 miles away, riding in these vehicles, where you wonder if at times people have really done the homework on things. And so that was my other anecdote that it really struck me. Now, next chart, final chart. And then we'll get some, y'all got some questions. Okay, this is the big vacuum chamber. And he's, now then, get to Apollo 17. Well, first, I want to show you a little bit about how much dust we got on the astronauts. When you lost that right rear fender, that meant that the dust rooster tailed up and it covered the astronauts. And here they are trying to brush themselves off with the single dust brush that they had and commenting about it. They are really dusty. They were almost black. These used to be pristine white suits.
And that dust went inside and stopped up the heating and air conditioning filters inside the limb.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. And so the rover contributed to that. Let's go on to the next chart because we want to get to some questions y'all may have. So Apollo 17, unfortunately, Gene Cernan, the commander, did the same exact thing. Caught the hammer out of on the suit, under the extension, popped it off. At least they knew it was earlier in the mission, and that mission. So John Young was put in charge, since he's had the Apollo 16 event. He was put in charge of going back inside, doing some testing there in Houston. They come up with a process of taking some maps out of the lunar module, putting securing them together with some duct tape, and taking some clamps off off the inside of the lunar module. They came back out, clamped them on, and it worked great. I wanted to stress here that we did have computer models, like I said, which were correlated. We had a big detailed model, as you can see here, before Apollo 15. That was very cumbersome to run with card decks and such. I was assigned the job of simplifying that, so I modeled just the forward chassis assembly for Apollo 16 and 17. I did receive the Apollo Silver Snoopy, which I proudly wear on my lapel, and that's probably the best award that I ever got. Very few people get it, and it was a very total surprise when I received that. This shows how well we got. Houston, the people out there in Mission Control in Houston, they almost, when they ask you a question, it's almost like they expect that you already know the answer. So it was very important to have the computer models be high in correlation. Notice here this slope here. If we hadn't opened the covers right here at about an hour and a half in, we would have exceeded the battery temperature about midway through the EVA. We told Houston, open the covers, got some cool down, changed the performance, and actually got about temperature about 139 at the end. And I wanted to point out to y'all, there are resources for you to go to. The Apollo Lunar Surface Journal by a fellow in Australia is very good. There's books that helped with, and so did Sonny and Skeet helped with, especially this book here. This workshop manual is done by some guys in England, of all places. Not in America, in England. Okay, and in fact, you'll find the Discovery Channel from Canada has also done some good. They did the Moon Machine movies. If you want to get the Moon Machine movies, some of us are in the Moon Machine movies. But this is the great research manual. I'm working on a book which I'll put out someday. We're hoping to have a 50th anniversary reunion of the rover people in 2021 for us that are still around. And that's all I've got. And if y'all got any questions.
Thank you very much, Ron. Okay, Skeet's got a question.
No, I got an answer.
Okay, good, I'll take that.
I should have mentioned that the wire mesh wheel concept, like I said, was from a guy named Thomas Ricketson, 1857, but we got the proposal, he got the concept of the wheel, but we didn't know how to make the wheel, and that was a real problem. So we selected stainless steel piano wire, 0.0084 millimeters in diameter, zinc coated to give it strength. And then the problem was, how do we make the wheel? So we had to find some basket weavers that actually could basket weave the wire. So we actually built a jig. General Motors actually built a jig, And the basket weavers actually wove the tires for us, and it takes about one day to make one tire.
We had so much data out there that we could keep you all through the evening. So, Ron, do you have another comment?
I forgot my going off the stage to comment. Okay. When the missions were all over, Hugh Campbell and I sat there. We just shook our heads in regret here that we'd had the astronauts spend so much time dealing with something we never should have had them dealing with. But we didn't have the budget, the weight budget, to do how we really should have done it with a closed-up system. We just didn't have the budget. But we were very aware that, in a way, we'd not engineered it the best way. But we got by.
Okay, appreciate it. Does anybody have any questions that came up that you'd like to ask?
I don't have a question, but I just had something I thought would add.
Dick.
Can you hear me okay?
No.
Okay. Most people don't have any problem listening to me.
We're recording.
Right. After the Apollo 15 flight, we found that the flight crew had dropped the seat belts between the seats, and for the majority of the time they were on the lunar surface, they drove without seat belts because they couldn't get to them. There wasn't enough room between the two seats to put a wrist ring down through it to get a hold of the seat belts. So we had 1 month to come up with another set of seat belts for the last two missions. And we came up with in 1 month, we came up with three different designs, and then another one that we from the Crew Systems Division made a suggestion to, which used the old trucker over-center latch system using the suit as a spring, which reduced the complexity of the design. We flew it on the KC-135. The flight crew selected that one, and it flew for 16 and 17, no problem.
Very much. Appreciate that.
Another place Marshall Center moves fast.
Okay, anybody in the audience have a question? Gene, you got any final words you'd like to say?
Amen.
So when we come up on the 55th anniversary, the 50th anniversary of the rover, I want you in that same seat. There you go.
Why were there three rovers? Could the first one not be reused for the second and third mission?
They landed in different places. We were looking for different mineral sites to go to. Somebody else want to offer a feedback on that?
When I told people this, I get that question all the time. I get that question all the time because some astronauts have said, oh, we just go back up to the moon, we put new batteries in. No, wait a minute, folks. There's been 600 thermal cycles on the moon, plus or minus 280, 290, plus or minus a 600 degree ramp. Okay, in addition, we had no preparations ahead of time to remove the old batteries and to guide the new batteries in. And luckily, we have what's called the Van Allen belts, protecting the Earth from the cosmic rays and things out there. I say luckily, although I believe somebody put them there. But those rays have bombarded the moon for eons, and they continue to bombard the moon. The moon is a harsh environment, and you've got to prepare for it.
If you went up there real quick, only used half the capacity of the batteries that Wayne used to calculate how long they would last.
It was more like about 40%, 35-40%. People ask about Apollo 18. There was an Apollo 18. There was a fourth rover. The parts were acquired, but it was never put together. And those parts are down at the Cape in their replica assembly.
Any other questions?
I was in high school when these activities were going on. Found it tremendously inspiring for the rest of my life. Thank you guys for your great work. God bless you. Great job.
I wasn't surprised Scott dropped his seatbelt, because when we went down to the crew checkout at the Cape, he didn't like that big metal thing. He took a pair of scissors, cut that off, and threw it on the counter, and all the qual guys went crazy. Because you were supposed to touch flight hardware. He just cut the thing off and threw it away. So he didn't have much sympathy in it. Another thing to talk about, Gene, when we went to the first time they tried to employ the rover up in Grumman, big drum roll, pull the lever, nothing happened.
That's right.
It was a little embarrassing. So that's why, but I'd say one thing. That was a really a good program between NASA, Boeing, General Motors, teamwork. There was no them or us. It was because we didn't have time for a them or us attitude. It really worked out well. All you guys did a good job that are still out here. They could do it again, I'm sure.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Skeet's got one more.
One other thing I mentioned. In the wheel design, there's 800 strands of wire in each wheel, and there's 64,000 intersections in the wire.
Okay.
Richard? My late wife, Miriam, was working with in Bob Schwinghammer's lab, and as I recall, she cut her hand or finger on one of the chevrons. Apparently, those were in sort of coils, and I think she said they were titanium. Could you confirm that and maybe talk a little bit about the chevrons?
Chevrons were titanium. Titanium on the chevrons? I see some head nods, so everybody agrees.
Yeah, the chevron served as two purposes. One, they kept the wheel from penetrating too much further in the soil, and also they gave us more traction when we tried to climb over rocks and things like that.
Just a question on the license plate. What was the story behind that, and who sanctioned that?
Well, hey, y'all be sure to go by and see. We got an exhibit here that's very good. It's called Apollo When We Went to the Moon, and the students out at Calhoun Community College updated a traveling replica, and it has the wire mesh wheels with the chevrons, as well as it's done very well.
Ron, what about the license plate? Do you know how they sequenced those?
Well, the story there is we had from the manned flight awareness program, we had a paper version of the license tag came around to us to keep us enthused, to keep us motivated. We don't believe that there ever was a license plate put on the rovers on the moon. And some of the astronauts did leave. Dave Scott did leave pictures of his whole family up by the hand controller. I've seen that picture. And there's also the astronauts actually on Apollo 17 brought back the fender extensions, didn't tell us about it. And we went out there and interviewed them at Houston. And we're kind of a little upset about that. But then they showed up at the Kansas Cosmosphere on exhibit. And one of them's up there at the Smithsonian right now. So some things were brought back.
Okay, any other questions?
I want to mention one more thing. You have a lunar driver's license in a simulator.
Right.
I have a lunar driver's license signed by Charlie Duke.
Cool.
I just wanted to say one more thing. When we went a few months later, I was working Skylab. I was not working Lunar Rover directly. And I happened to run into Jim Lovell at Charlie Duke's house. And he told me that after he was scared to death that they were just going to flip the rover because Dave Scott had spun it twice on the lunar surface.
Okay, any other questions? Sonny, anything else?
I have a comment.
It's on.
Yeah, I'd just like to say one thing. Getting back to Von Braun again, one of his principles that certainly is evident just by the people you heard today speaking, with the exception of me, but his theory is that select people who know more than you do when you're organizing a team. Okay? Think about that. There are a lot of organizations that don't do that, but we certainly do at Marshall Space Flight Center, and it's evidenced right by the people you've heard today talk.
Joe, you have anything else?
How about a hand for our panel today?
This is truly oral history. I hope y'all are enjoying and taking advantage of the insight that has been brought to us, that we can celebrate the past and inspire the future. So next week, we're taking a break during the 4th of July. We don't have a panel next week. On July 11th, which is the following Thursday, I think Ron Bledsoe will lead us in a panel that addresses Apollo propulsion and engines. So that's a pretty
a broad gamut to do. And I will say, Taylor from Polaris, stand up. This workforce that y'all heard today has managed to connect with today's workforce. Many of you have seen and are aware of a project that Polaris has undertaken to do a one-to-one replica of the lunar rover. And they did that because these gentlemen and ladies went out to visit with them and asked for their assistance in doing something to celebrate Apollo, to lead a procession downtown for dancing in the streets on the 19th. And Polaris kind of looked with their 60 design engineers and said, you know, we build off-road vehicles, all-terrain vehicles, and we want to build the ultimate all-terrain vehicle. So they are wrapping up. Some have seen their close-to-finished product of a one-to-one replica of the lunar rover, and it will debut on July 13th at the car show here at the Rocket Center. I think if you're lucky enough, you can probably get a ride on it that day. And so, Taylor, to you and your workforce at Polaris, we're looking forward to it. We thank you for your efforts in trying to be part of this community and to do something to connect with Apollo.
I got to drive it, and it was fun. Sonny got to drive it. So it's got double Ackerman steering. I mean, going down the road, it looks like the real deal.
Well, they're inspired by these folks and you folks who are here today. We're so grateful to have this opportunity here in 2019 and the 50th anniversary. So we got a little weather outside. There's no severe weather, but there is some weather out there. Beer garden is within the half hour. Y'all please enjoy yourself and have a great 4th. Is it tonight at the library? Okay, is that Zach's movie?
Yeah,
so Zach Weil and is a young man who has interviewed not only folks here in Huntsville, but in other NASA centers. If I had to put a film that told the story of what has happened at Marshall, it's this film. And are they charging? Is it free? Free?
It's free.
All right, so at the Huntsville Public Library. So it'll be limited seating. Now, I think we also have plans, Kenny, in future beer gardens as we go into July to show that film here. So it'll be at the Davidson Center. But don't miss an opportunity to see it. It's really good. And I think there is an Alabama Public Television scheduled for in...
July 7th.
Is it July 7th?
July
7th at 5:30
on PBS.
All right. So for our folks, July 7th, 5:30 on... Public Television, Alabama Public Television. So that's it's a wonderful testament to what the 60s and the Apollo era meant. And there are 18 people interviewed in this film. I dare say about 9 of them are this group that was here. So any other announcements?
Just got one thing. For those of you that want to stay, I've got a video here that shows the receipt of the first lunar roving vehicle. We'll see Sonny's picture in it at the end. Gene's in there probably. If you want to stay around, feel free to. If you're ready to exit, please go see the static display back here in the back.
One more.
One thing I might mention.
Engineers have a bad tendency to go into a lot of details. And this project would not have worked had it not been for a tremendous communications network that supported the missions. And it worked so that, you know, if there were any problems that arose within a matter of a few seconds to a few minutes, we could have been working on an answer to support the success of the mission. The second thing is we have some good charts down here in front that have a lot of the technical details of the lunar rover and the missions that you may want to take care of if you have tendencies to be an engineer.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming today. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. 3, 2, 1, 0.